Jana Gass over there, and she gave an amazing talk on products. And she comes off stage, and she says, you know, here I am at an innovation conference, and I'm talking about products. And these people didn't even know what I was talking about, and I totally bombed. She was wrong, she blocked it. But she really felt like people didn't get what she had to say. And so that got us talking. I'm like, well, I'm wondering if I should go and talk about innovation at a product conference. And so I was talking to Janet, I talked to Martin, and they go, you know what you should name your talk? You should name your talk, Innovation Programs Suck Because Product Manager's Fault. Okay, that's a good idea. I'll go do that talk. And I think that was maybe too much, so they didn't put it on the website. But let's have a conversation about innovation. Do you guys do innovation? Is innovation part of your job title? Is it in your job description? Do you have to be innovative? Yep. So what does innovation mean? And who owns innovation, right? It's, to some people, it's having ping pong tables and Nerf guns. That's innovation. If you use Post-it notes, you're innovating. It's ideation. So big companies often have these whole competitions where everybody comes up with the greatest idea, right? Could be new technology. Most big companies think about technology when they're talking about innovation, even though that's invention, not innovation. And then, of course, marketing has their own way of talking about innovation. Is there any Fortune 500 company that doesn't have innovative or industry leader innovation somehow on their About Me page, on their website? So the problem is that none of these organizations really, or very few of them, stop and define what they mean by innovation. And so therefore they run programs all throughout their company that are all innovative. Well, so here's the real issue. So the real issue, your company is on this curve. Like imagine that existing product forecast at the top of a S-curve for a particular product. Your companies have a range of products and they're all in a different portion of their life cycle. Your products are going to come to an end sometime. It's going to be sooner if you're being disrupted. It might be a long time. But what I want you to glean from this is the amount of uncertainty that you have in your organization when you're trying to achieve your strategic priorities, you're trying to achieve your growth rate. The amount of uncertainty grows based upon where you are or where your products are on this life cycle. And so really innovation is around where's this uncertainty and how am I going to tackle that uncertainty. And so the way I like to think about it is that you have sort of the known and the unknown. Known is how am I going to execute in my known market. Problems are well understood, solutions are well understood. I can go talk to my customers and believe what they say when they give me feedback. I have a blueprint on how to market and sell and produce products that fit inside that market. And so we manage people and we organize our company around executing on this known roadmap. And on the unknown, of course, this is often represented by startups. Markets are not well understood. Problems are not well understood. Solutions are not well understood. We don't have a roadmap yet on how to market and sell. We have to learn all of these things first. We have to create that roadmap, and so then we can put it into our execution engine, and we're off and running. Until the product starts to decline or competition comes in. So the point is that even in execution mode, even with our known roadmap and our known blueprint, there is some amount of uncertainty, right? So it could be that your strategic priority is that we need to grow 10% next year. And you know how to get there 95% of the way. Increase productivity, lower costs, increase efficiencies, open up a new market in a different region. I'm confident, 95% confident that I know how to hit my strategic objectives next year. Well, that 5% of uncertainty that remains is the unknown. And we have to operate differently in the unknown than we do in the known. So that's where I talk about the entrepreneurial spirit, or lean innovation. Empathy, understanding our customers deeply. Experiments, validating or invalidating our riskiest assumptions. and using evidence to inform our decisions. What I love about this conference is you already know how to do this. So the first Minds of Potter conference I spoke at was back in 2013. It was their second one ever. And, you know, sort of lean startup was the buzzword of the day, and that's what I was talking about. And I don't know, kind of back in those days, I was really proud of myself because I felt like I had introduced the concept of empathy into the lean startup dialogue. And there was a bunch of designers that were actually presenting that day, some UX people, and they all said, you know what, we've been doing this for ages. And they're right. And then I would talk to agile programmers, the developers, and they say, yeah, we've been doing this experimentation stuff for ages. That's true too. So it's Silicon Valley often wants to pretend that they invent everything, and there is some good that comes from reinvention because we can actually do things a little bit better. But lean innovation is what I consider the combination of design thinking and lean startup tailored for the enterprise and being agile. And so again, I actually think when I listen to people talk here at the conference and the leadership session the other day, people already do this. Product managers have absorbed this way of thinking into their work, which is awesome. Well, so what's the issue? How do we actually improve innovation? What does all of this have to do with helping innovation teams be more innovative? Well, I don't know if you've heard of horizon planning, but there's this concept of there's three horizons that we should develop products for. First one is called Horizon 1, and that's basically incrementally improving our existing products. Then there's a Horizon 2, and that's a little bit more innovative, and we're not going to see it for several years. And then there's a Horizon 3, which is breakthrough innovation. And part of the problem is that the innovation groups are charged with doing breakthrough innovation, but they're asked to get a return on investment right away. It's not possible. And so where I think you all can help out is redefining what these horizons are. So the first one is what I call an H0. And these are the core internal processes inside your company. This is finance, this is HR, it's IT, it's legal compliance. They actually have to also learn how to apply empathy, experiments, and evidence inside the core business. Everybody inside the company has a customer. Everybody can get empathy. Everybody can run these experiments to see if their solutions are correct. So that's H0. H1 is sort of this continuous improvement with our existing products. Again, I think that this is what you guys already do super well. You're going out and, you know, empathy is now a buzzword inside of companies. This is extraordinary. It's maybe a little bit depressing that empathy could be a buzzword, but if any enterprise actually gets just a small part of empathy, that can only be a good thing. And so then what we want to think about with these H2s is new growth. So let's forget about, again, the concept of innovation. Just where is the growth going to come from for our company? Where's the revenue going to come from that's 2 or 3 years out? And this could be launching existing products into a new market, or it could be better serving an existing market, or it could be going and trying to launch in a new country. We just don't know. It's going to take 2 or 3 years for us to develop the roadmap for executing in those new markets or developing those new products. And then H3 is we want to still sort of break through what we're hoping to see this non-linear growth happen in the future. And so eventually what this comes down to is portfolio management. How do we invest early, or how do we invest money where we're short in this concept of 0 to 5 years or 0 to 7 years? And so here's some of the things that I think that you guys can help with. Number one is you're running experiments, and that's great, but you need to run more bold experiments. So experiments is not just split testing. Running experiments is a rigorous approach to brainstorming your assumptions, prioritizing based upon what is the risk of this assumption. So from your customer's perspective, what must be true for this product to work in the marketplace? That's your riskiest assumption. Now I want to design an experiment that measures customer behavior that validates or invalidates that riskiest assumption. So we'll have teams that are, we think that there's a hospital that up in Seattle where the doctors and nurses are not washing their hands enough, which is kind of scary. And so this hospital team came up with this idea that we could like produce this atomizer that the surgeons would put their hands in this box and it would clean their hands and they'd be done and it would only take 30 seconds. So they built a prototype out of cardboard and went to the hospital and had these doctors, and they have photographs of the doctors standing there with their hands in the box for 30 seconds. So it's behavior that is indicating that yes, surgeons would be willing to do that, because if they not willing to do that, that product won't work. So when you think of experiments, I want you to think, you know, beyond producing product. How do I produce something where the behavior indicates that people will be willing to engage with the value that you're creating for them? It's not the same thing as a minimum viable product, in my opinion. A minimum viable product is one where you're actually producing enough product that you can test whether that is viable. So one way to think about the running more bold experiments is that you have, naturally we optimize around the local maximum, right? So we're split testing and we're trying to figure out if the messaging on a website is working or whether the color of the button, and we can get enough website data that we can actually evaluate whether a change has produced the desired result. So that's great, we should do that, but build into your cadence once a month or once a quarter and do like a Google design sprint or some sort of a sprint where you're gonna go outside of this local maximum and try a big experiment and see if one of those things actually moves the needle more than all of these smaller experiments. So you wanna build that into your cadence. So when we get to empathy, again, we hear this all the time that people are out doing empathy. And I think the point here is that you want to go deeper than you've gone before in terms of your empathy. So we're talking aspirations here. We're not talking about simply, will this person use the product? You're not asking them questions where they're predicting their future. Customers are horrible at predicting their own future. You're not asking them, would you like it or would you not like it? You're not asking them to look at your prototype when you're doing the empathy work. It's observing them. Understanding what drives them, what motivates their purchases. How can you change their life? What's the impact your product would have on your life? And these are insights that you can glean that will inform not only how you incrementally improve your existing products, but also will speak then to some of those H2s and maybe even the Horizon 3s out there. So there was a Techstar startup that I was helping called Filter.ai that spent 2 weeks just hanging out inside of this Fortune 100 company, observing their hiring practice. And I wrote about this on a blog post about feedback that's on Medium right now. But what they found out like crazy stuff that had nothing to do with the product that they were developing. The fact that recruiters would be using the company's recruiting software to figure out what the questions were that were going to be asked, and they would send these questions to the job applicant, and the job applicants were like logging on and pretending to be a recruiter so that they could get the questions. It was like this crazy amount of fraudulent activity that they then built into the site. There was also this they observed an interview. So imagine you're a software engineer and you're going into this large company. And you're there to take a coding test, and there's the filter.ai guy, and the hiring manager comes in, shows the guy the person the coding test, watches the person code for 2 minutes. The hiring manager looked at the startup guy, goes, this person can't code, and walked out of the room. The startup person actually had to escort this person back out. That was the amount of frustration with the hiring process. It was costing them $40,000 to hire a software engineer. Just this cultural effect that this was having on them informed the product decision they made. So if they had just gone and done, you know, sort of shallow empathy, they might have learned something about the frustration, but actually just hanging out, just being there for 2 weeks, gave them a greater insight to not only the way the HR department was functioning, but also the hiring manager. So don't think about customer interviews as sort of this checkbox item. You have to deeply understand your customers. And this is gonna be giving you, you know, sort of fodder for your future growth. So again, sort of this local maximum versus your real goal. Features versus aspiration, right? So not how do I get my people to use, but my customers to use the product more, but how can I understand what the impact my products are having on my customers' life? So the other part is data. We talk about data a lot. We talk about metrics. We talk about vanity metrics a lot, right? So when we talk about our customers and the way they're behaving, we want to make sure that what we're measuring actually has an impact on the product success. So the thing I want to challenge with you here is think about how you actually transform the way you do work inside your business. So the way that we're trying to establish what our growth rates are for 3 years from now, what do we have to do to change our behavior? What indicates that our senior leaders are buying into this way of working? What is the behavior that I can measure of my team members that they're actually doing deeper empathy? What is the behavior of senior leadership when it comes to allowing us to run bigger experiments? So the way we transform our organizations is by looking at ourselves, looking at our team members, looking at our colleagues, and thinking about what is the behavior that indicates that this change is happening. So I want you to sort of turn this up. Again, I think you guys probably already do this really well when it comes to your products facing your customers. We're not doing vanity metrics so much anymore. Think about how you turn that internally. What is the behavior that indicates that we're changing? So I just wanted to use this chart again. So the last thing I want you to think about is radical restructuring. So basically the way we structure our companies today is based upon the assembly line. It's based upon the industrial age. So it's all based upon our specialization of trades. So that's why we have marketing organization and sales organization and engineering, product management, operations, facilities. And it's the very nature of that structure is what makes us slow, not able to change our processes based upon incoming new information. Only some of these groups are allowed to talk to customers. So all of those things that I discussed before, the problems that we're facing, actually culture comes out of the structure of the company. And so I really believe that the companies that are going to survive are ones that are able to radically restructure the company. So the prime example is maybe Spotify. And so you've maybe read about that. They've got some nice videos on their website about it. Basically, they've got guilds, where the guilds are based upon a function. So that's where your specialization of trade lives, is your marketing guild and your sales guild and different elements of engineering skills. And then what they do is they form teams that cross all the guilds, and those teams are assigned a mission. And so this is also very much like the way the military has sort of restructured a lot of their special forces teams. It's the same sort of thing. Anybody can emerge as the leader based upon the mission that they have. The mission is tied to a metric, and you're going to assemble the team based upon going into these guilds. So the crazy thing is, ING, one of the largest banks in Europe, has restructured whole banking units based upon the Spotify model. And what they found was that those teams acted in this lean innovation way, way better than the other structured teams. So the organization becomes flatter. And here's another way to illustrate it. So in my framework, in my book, The Lean Entrepreneur, I talk about seven states that a customer goes through from first becoming aware to becoming passionate. So they first obviously get knowledge of the product, then they become intrigued because the messaging speaks to them. Then they become trusting and they think, okay, well, this company can deliver on the promise they've given me. Then they become convinced and they buy. Then they go through this funky state of being hopeful, which basically is you need to get them to try the value to to achieve the value as quickly as possible. For example, it's why we buy toys that say batteries included, right? You don't have to run to the store and buy batteries, or else you're losing that, potentially are losing a satisfied customer. So after hopefully you've become satisfied, that's because the promise has been fulfilled, and then there's this crazy other step that people don't think about, which is passion. So seven states that a customer goes through. Imagine if your company was structured around forming teams, forming a SWAT team or a special forces team that takes out a bottleneck that exists somewhere in, these are all, it's a conversion funnel, right? And so you could focus these teams around doing empathy, running experiments, and seeking evidence based upon wherever the bottleneck is in that product. And so this is sort of the radical type of cross-functionality. Cross-functionality is not just, you know, asking a marketing person to join your team or having one salesperson. Radical restructuring is finding from those guilds all those people that you need in order to move the needle in somewhere in the product, in that conversion cycle. So in this example, you can see that team one is choosing four or five people from those. They actually think about what is the bottleneck, or they're using data because they're tracking the conversions from each one of those steps, and they can see where it is that if they go remove that bottleneck, they should see growth. And they can, of course, apply this anywhere along that growth cycle. So fundamentally, it's, in my view, innovation needs to be redefined so that innovation is only doing that H3 stuff again. So then they can go back to doing the breakthrough stuff and nobody's expecting a return on investment. But they can only do that if the core product teams are taking care of the H1s, the Horizon 1s, and the H2s. And so in the end, what, in my opinion, what you need is the core business, the core continuous improvement is product. You need an incubator that's run by a business unit, and those also have people like yourselves that are running the deeper empathy, the bigger experiments, and using evidence to figure out where that growth is going to come from. So hopefully, you will help me help innovation teams by applying this to 2 or 3 years down the road and not just your existing products. So that's what I have to say. Thank you so much.